everyone. So today we're going to talk about a little bit of a real-world application of statics, which involves some environmental considerations. So let's see what we have. We're talking today about a power plant, and a classic power plant setup is shown in front of you, and these power plants typically have some intake canals when it's near the ocean to intake some cool water from the ocean for cooling purposes of the power plant. So water comes in here, seawater comes in, goes through the power plant, you know, cooling system, and then eventually the water gets discharged back into the ocean. Now the environmental problem arises from young turtles. So like we see here, you know, we have some young turtles that are on the beach, and you know, they're in the water as well. And what can happen is that the water current here in the intake canal just entrains basically turtles with it, and will take turtles into the plant. And this is a serious environmental problem because it will cause large amounts of turtles to get killed. So there is a solution to this type of problem, and the solution is actually shown on the diagram here. And the solution is to have some sort of grid. So at point A here, we have an image of a grid. And this grid would be used to intercept turtles before they get to the power plant. So this would save their lives. So this is a great engineering solution to this problem. So what we'll do today is we'll do a little bit of analysis on the grids and see if we can design a grid that would save these turtles. So going into a little bit more details on the grid itself, so I have just another schematic here. What this grid here would involve is a series of closely spaced incline bars, and the spacing would, of course, allow, you know, water would still flow through this grid. However, the turtles would be stopped. So the grid holes would not be large enough to allow these turtles to go through. So the turtles basically could actually even climb up the grid. And the best design of this grid would have some sort of platform at the top to allow the turtles to be collected and then eventually returned to the ocean. So the first thing we want to do today then, now that we understand a little bit this grid design, is we want to answer a first very fundamental question, is can the turtle move up this grid if the angle theta with the horizontal here is 90 degrees? And we're told to assume some value. So I give you here, you know, the submerged weight of the turtle, the drag force from the water. The turtle has a forward propelling force. And of course, there is some friction along this grid here. So we have the coefficient of static friction that's given to us. So let's do then our analysis. We're going to start with a free body diagram on the turtle. So an FBD. And we're going to take this grid as a vertical grid. So let's see if we can do that. So imagining this is our grid. So it's vertical, 90 degrees here with the horizontal. So this is 90 degrees. And we then have our nice little turtle here that we'll draw a free body diagram on it. Okay. So the forces on this turtle are the following. First we have, and I'll take a different color to put in these forces, let's take blue. We have the weight of our turtle, so our little turtle has a weight, and we're told it's 1 newton, so 1N. We have its forward propelling force of 2 newtons, so it's propelling up the grid. So this upwards force here will be, we'll label it as P for the propelling force. So this is 2 newtons. We have the drag force from the water. So this is a horizontal force. So this D, this drag force here, is 6 newtons from our stated assumptions. And then what we have to remember, we're dealing with a surface here. So two things, there's the friction and the normal force. So we have an N here that is perpendicular to our grid. And last but not least, we do have a friction force, so opposing motion. So this friction force F is pointing downwards. And keep in mind that the impending motion of this turtle is upwards. So I'm just going to draw a dotted upward arrow to give you the impending motion. I'll just label this as IM for impending motion. Okay. So if we take our equilibrium equations and we solve for some of our unknowns, we'll be able to find our friction force and figure out if it can move up the grid. So first, let's label, I did forget to put this in, so right to the right is X, to upwards is Y. So we'll take first our sum of forces in the X, so positive to the right, sum of forces in the X direction is equal to zero. So what we can see here, the only two forces in the X direction are D, the drag force, and N. We know the value of D, so we can conclude that the normal force then will be 6 newtons. And similarly, we can take positive as upwards, sum of forces in the Y is equal to zero. And then we can see we have the upward propelling force of 2, downward force of the weight is 1, and we have another downward force, the friction force here. So you can see that for equilibrium, this friction force F must equal 1 newton. Okay, so this is an important piece of information. So what we want to do is we want to take this friction force that we just found, and we want to compare it to the critical friction force. So what we need to remember is one more thing, is that our critical friction force, we'll call it F sub C, this is equal to the coefficient of static friction, so this is nu, times the normal force. So if we put in some numbers here, this coefficient of static friction was 0.8, and 6 was our value of the normal force. So our critical friction force is 4.8 newtons. So for the turtle to be able to move up this grid, if it's 90 degrees, would have to have a friction force in the system that is greater than the critical friction, and that is not the case. So the answer, and I'll take I'll go back to blue here for our answer. The answer to this question then, can the turtle move up the grid when the angle is 90 degrees? The answer is no, it cannot. And the reason is because this friction force is less than the critical friction force. So F is less than FC, so that will not allow the turtle to move up the grid. So we've at least answered one question. We know that this grid cannot be set at 90 degrees. So the next thing that we would like to do then is figure out, well, what would be the minimum angle, so we'll call this one theta C, that will allow the turtles to move up the grid. So let's then continue our analysis and let's draw a new free body diagram. And this time we're going to look at this grid if it was inclined. So free body diagram, FBD here. So now let's look at this incline. Imagine our grid is inclined. So with the horizontal, we'll label this as theta C. This is the angle we want to find. Okay. And let's look at our little turtle then, and let's label all our forces on our turtle in the same way we did before, but along this incline. So I'll take again a different color, and let's look at what we have. So again, we have a weight, the weight of the turtle straight down I'll just draw it here out of the way, but this is our W. It's a vertical weight, so this is W is 1 newton, we said. There's still the drag force coming in from the water. That's a horizontal force. So that's the D is equal to 6 newtons. Right. We have the forward propelling force of the turtle. So please remember, the turtle now is trying to move up the grid. So that forward propelling force is along the angle of that grid. So this is P. This was 2 newtons. And then the last two things are our friction force and our normal force. So now, because we're looking for this minimum angle, our friction force here opposing the motion, this is our critical friction force. So remember that this is 0.8 times the normal, and the normal is right here, perpendicular to, so this is a perpendicular to the grid surface. Okay, so we have all our forces now in our free body diagram. Let's not forget our axes. So for convenience, I'll declare along the grid here as our x-axis, and then perpendicular to the grid will be our y-axis here. And from trigonometry, if we see theta c is here with the horizontal, it also means that this angle here is also theta c. And then it means we can label this one as well as theta c. And that might help us a little bit with our calculations. So as before, we'll do our equilibrium equations and we'll see what we can solve. So first we have our x, sum of forces in the x. So positive then is upwards to the right here for x. Sum of forces in the x equal to 0. So let's see what we have for our forces then. So we have 2, the propelling force here, which is in the positive x direction. We have the friction force, which is in the negative x direction. So that's 0.8 times n. And then we have the x component of the drag force. So that's looking like a 6. Times cosine of that critical angle that we're looking for. And lastly, we have the x component of the weight, which is acting in the negative x direction. So negative, the value of the weight here is 1. And then this is sine of theta c to get its component. So all of this is equal to 0. So this will be our equation 1. And similarly, then we'll do the same for our sum of forces in the y. So positive now is upwards and to the left. Sum of forces in the y is equal to 0. So now in this case, looks like we have n, which is in the positive y. We have the y component of the drag force. So we're at negative 6. Sine of theta c, and we have the y component of the weight, so negative 1, and this is now a cosine of theta c. So all of this now is equal to 0 for equilibrium. So this is our second equation. So basically we have 2 equations, 2 unknowns. So what we'll do is I'll use equation 2. So I'll use 2 and I'll just isolate for n. So if we rearrange equation 2 and solve for n, we'll just get n is 6 sine of theta c plus 6 cosine of theta c. And what I'll do is I'll take this value of n here, And I will put that into equation one, our first equation. And that way I will only have theta c as my unknown. So let's just put down some values here. So back to one. So if we're using equation one now, we'll get 2 minus 0.8 times n. So let's put in n. So n we said is 6 sine of theta c plus cosine of theta c. And then the remaining part of the equation is 6 cosine of theta c. And then lastly, we have minus sine of theta c. All this equal to 0. So if we just tidy things up a little bit, we'll be getting 2 plus 5.2 cosine of theta c minus 5.8 sine of theta c equal to 0. So at this point, with the trig here, we can use a calculator, a solver, Excel, your preference. So I just used a solver here. So using a solver, I was able to figure out what value of theta c I can get to satisfy this equation. And it comes that theta c is equal to 56.8 degrees with 3 significant figures. So this right here is the answer that we're looking for. So what this means is that for the turtle to be able to move up this net, the angle must be less than 56. So 56.8, is the critical angle. So anything less than this critical angle, the turtle can move up the grid. Anything more than the critical angle, and the turtle will not be able to move up the grid. So this concludes our lecture on statics for today. I hope you enjoyed this problem, and thank you for tuning in.